Hi, welcome to my channel, My Children and Engineer. Today I'm continuing with the series of videos I'm doing about machine learning and MLOps in Databricks. I will show you how to work with the Hugging Face transformers with some of the use cases of the generative AI in Databricks. Okay, I just create an output as usual that later on I will upload to the repository. I will put a link on the description of the video. You will be able to access to it. And I'm assuming that you had your workspace created. It's not you had a video as well on the channel how to create a workspace. In this case, in the case of the video, I use Microsoft Azure, but the process is very similar in any of the cloud providers, main cloud providers, Azure, Google, or AWS. In any of them, if you are just trying, you should go for a trial. The trial is 14 days in which you can use Databricks for free. You cannot create a very big cluster in the trial, but more than enough to run this all the notebooks on all the experiments I'm doing in these videos. In this case, I had created a single workspace with a machine learning runtime 13.3 version, and all, one of the smallest clusters that you may find on the list of available you have here. Is a cluster for general purpose with a little bit more hard disk in this case, and well, the configuration is pretty normal. In this case, as you can see, I'm using a single node. This means that we had the driver and the working on the same box. And here what we are gonna see is everything pure Python. Is not we are not going to use on that videos in that video transformers, meaning that, and that was the reason that to use a single node, because we are not going to take any advantage of the distributed environment. It's just pure Python. It's just to show you how you can work as you probably are doing in your Jupyter notebook or in Jupyter Lab, but in this time, or Google Colab, but this time doing in Databricks, and you will see that it's exactly the same. We will cover some use cases, and that's it. Again, you need the the Databricks workspace. Look at the video. You don't know how to do it, write me a message on the channel and I will help you. It's very easy, and you already had a video on how to do this. And the second thing that you will need is the token, Hugging Face token, to access to the models and data sets that we are going to use in this video. So let's start. Once you had the cluster created, you started, and then on we install the libraries we need. If this is not the recommendable way to do it, if you want to do something, solo install some libraries, you should go to libraries in your cluster and install new, and use PyIP, maybe in CRAN, depending on the language or the type of library you want to install, Python, Java, Scala, or R. And in this case, it's the path where you have it, your workspace, the data lake, or the Databricks file system. This is the recommendable way to do it, but in case that you are gonna use it just for this experiment, you can do it that way, but you will receive this Notice this warning that you may need to restart the Python library. Okay, you can do it with dbutils. Dbutils is a tool developed by Databricks. I'm just working inside Databricks workspace, or in the command line if you are working with the Databricks CLI. But well, mostly essentially working on the workspace, you can do a lot of things. You can access secrets, file system, run notebooks, get parameters from other notebooks, and well, provide exit outputs back to other notebooks. You can set up pipelines, many things with dbutil. We will have a video just speaking about the tool. Again, it's a tool that is prioritarily used on the DB runtime and broadly used when you are working with the database. It's working in the four languages, in SQL, R, Scala, and PySpark. So once you know how it works, is gonna be the same for any language. Then on, as you can see here, I'm using the dbutil secrets. Secrets is the container, the vault that you had on your Databricks workspace to keep or to save secrets and keys and token keys, etc. I'm preparing a video as well how to work through the API. You had as well a video on the channel how to create clusters, submit jobs, etc. This is gonna be just the topic of secrets because it's quite important. And usually secrets in your workspace integrate with, in the case, for example, of Azure, with the Vault, in case of the other technologies with equivalent in Google or in Amazon to the Vault. This is done usually to when you are working with CI/CD pipelines or working with multiple technologies. The way to do it, again, you integrate, you have a key vault in Azure, and you integrate, for example, in this case, with the secrets container in your workspace, and you just the secrets container is just a bridge in between your key vault and the workspace. In this case, we are not doing this integration, and also this integration is set up as well in Google or in Amazon with the equivalent technologies. You can do this integration or use it directly as we are doing here. Here the only thing I'm doing is getting a secret, the HF underscore token, the Hugging Face token from the scope test dev, and assigning to this variable, and then on putting that environment, this value on the environment. If you cannot, you don't know how this works, you don't know how to create an scope and assign tokens to this, either take a look, depending when you watch the video, you probably will have the next video available where I speak about the tokens, about the secrets, sorry, and how to create it. It's not just assigned directly in your local environment the key here and that's it. No problem. So we import the libraries we need. You see exactly we are working in pure Python here. There is no PySpark. You are gonna see that here we will do five, six use cases with transformers, different models, different datasets, and as you can see, it's purely Python. This is for those that are familiar with the transformers. You will see that is exactly the same that working in a Python environment. There is no change. The only two small details that you should know to work in Databricks, and I will explain you which ones. Now we are going to do the first use case is summarization. We use a dataset exam, this BBC articles and summaries, and we use a T5 model, a very small model, 60 million from Google. We are working in a CPU cluster, we are not using GPU. You will see that we have enough, let me show you the metrics. So you can see here that memory is pretty much, we use everything, not much wrapping. The CPU, CPU is quite normal, so this cluster is more than enough for these activities we are doing here. So we load the dataset Exum, we just point to the data lake, to the Databricks file system, to a cache directory, to keep the datasets and models there. And that way we don't need to download it again next time. Just notice that when we are accessing to with a Python library, you need to access with this nomenclator. If you access with a PySpan library, you need to access with a URL similar to this. Okay, but that's is some of the details. If you are working again with a Python library, not with the PySpar, the paths change. And then also you are reading a CSV file or a TXT file with whatever. Everything that you use with the PySpar, with the Python libraries, you need to use OS Linux paths. If you use PySpar libraries, you need to use the Databricks nomenclator. So we load the summary, the dataset. As you can see, it's quite big dataset. We are going just to take 10 samples randomly. You can take a look here. It's gone already with a summary, proposes and idea of the article. We create the pipeline summarization with a model T5 small. It's again very, very small, but quite efficient for the purpose of what we are going to do here. Minimum length, maximum length of the summary, truncation. If there is the summary is longer than 100, we truncate it. And also we cache the model into the Databricks file system. Here we just make a summary of one of the documents. Here we just summarize in batch the 10 articles, and we here generate a data frame with the generated output, the summary on the data set and the document. You can see here display. Display is another library in Databricks, which do a pretty display in a comfortable display. You want to see as well, because you can see here that you can access the complete text. And if you are working with structured data like dictionaries or similar, like happens many times when you are working with the PySpar data frames, you are able to span or contract the objects and make an easy visualization of what contains these complex structures. And then display the same that the dbutils is working in any of the languages that you have available in Databricks, R, Scala or SQL, and also obviously Python, PySpar. Sentiment analysis, we take another dataset, also a model, a fine-tuned model that did a user, which published it on Hugging Face is free to use and to load. It's at the fine-tuned version of BERT. It's performing pretty well. So this is one of the topics I discuss. Not sentiment analysis. I'm using a lot this pipeline with the T5 models. In the channel, you have different versions of doing this, the fine-tuning of the T5 models. I use as well in one of the videos, if I don't remember one, I use as well the Bear case, but mostly T5 base size to do document classification or text classification. This case is as well text classification for classes. The data set is already built. Okay? And then on here, if you are using Bear case, the task is Bear classification. So this is an encoder. In top of the encoder, you have a linear classifier. You are classifying the text according and you provide a label together with a score. So we create the pipeline, the task is text classification model, and also to the cache. We make here some text with four, five, sorry, three texts. And here we just made the prediction in the sample example. You can see here later we create a data frame with the predicted label, the true label, the score we got, and the text. You can see here that the model is performing practically not perfect. In this case, maybe we try with all the examples. Probably, so here, let's take how many examples had the model. Yeah, it's not very big. We can do as well. This is not a big deal. Now translation, we use another data set. This Helsinki NLP had different data sets for different translation set tags. Here we use English to Spanish and as well a T5 small, which is really small model, but very, very efficient. A model from Google. You had all the links here as well. You can access the documentation. I advise you to do it just to get a clear idea of what these models are capable to do and well, also the background behind, no? We create the pipeline, translation in this case, the model, also the quick cache, the model. And here we just make a translation from English to Spanish. Take a look, there is again in Helsinki NLP, there is multiple languages, multiple pre-trained models which translate from English to different languages and vice versa. Here we use now. That's another example. We use the T5. For those that are familiar with T5, T5 is a generative model. It's not, and it was trained with some specific techniques, which and the model produced generators. The question is that we can use this text generation to produce just simply a label, and this is how we, in this case, we are going to translate text. And so we will generate text, and at the same time, we will be doing translation. You will see you can do this as well with other activities. Take a look to what is possible to do with the T5 series. They are really powerful models. I use it a lot. And well, again, in this case, we use a text-to-text, we don't use translation. We just use the model as text generation, and the model is capable to how to say to translate different languages, which is a slightly different approach to what we are doing here, no? It's just another example. And then here we can translate to French, but essentially probably we can translate as well to Spanish. Is that not wrong? Let me try it again. This is done. Oops. Translate, no. In this case, it's translated to German. Interesting. Let's generate again the probably something that I. One second. Yeah, sorry, my fault. It's not able to translate. Maybe we should take a bigger one. That this small version is only able to do translations in between these four languages. So yeah, here not possible to translate to English. Well, and also in German is quite bad the translation. Let's check the French. Probably the French is the German is terrible. Oh my gosh, the fight. Let's check it out again. Yeah. Well. I don't know what now is not working, but well, in any case, we can take a look to other Google T5 models, the T-Base or the T5 Large, which probably you see here also only these five languages, four languages, but yeah, probably this is gonna be. Let's take this one. And just let me one second. I suppose that let's take a wheel. This one. One second. Okay, yeah, that was the issue. Probably just I need to refresh and the or to place the small model in another. Probably something was corrupted. But well, with another model, you can see here that the translation is. I suppose accurate. Our preliminary categories, not really sure. Just here, probably 150. Let's take 250. We use that one. Because I think a powerful operable. Is those, yeah, C category probably is just translated to here. Let's take a little bit longer and more generation because it seems that it's not able to it is cutting the yeah, it's cutting here the part of the initial message. As you can see here, as we are working in a with CPU, not only not with GPU, just refresh the model. Probably is we have yeah we are using the whole memory and also this but the CPU is fine, not a problem. Well, still having this issue, but well, I will take a look later in the final version of the notebook. I will post to the repository. I will fix that and see what exactly is happening with this. Okay, let's move to the next. Now we are going to do prompting. We will use zero shot classification. We take some example from the Exum. We take NLI, Diverta. It's very powerful model as well from Microsoft. We just use the model zero shot classification with the model, and we provide a prompt. We want to classify the document versus different candidate labels. In this case, these labels can be they are arbitrary. You can use whatever you want. So we just create the we just call the pipeline. We pass the labels, and we produce a data frame as an output. We create here an article, and you can see here the classification versus the different labels that you provide. And the final example, FuSoft Learning, FuSoft Prompting in this case. We use here another model, GPT, also very powerful model. Take a look to this, very very small, but at the same time very powerful. You can see here the characteristics, the features of the model is performing really well in many of the benchmarks, and keeping the size really small for and very agile and very flexible the model. Yeah, it's, as you can see here, it's replicating the architecture of GPT-3. So, take a look to these models again. Probably I'm very heavy with that, but yeah, just take a look to the models. They are quite interesting, and when you are working in environments with not much memory or with small GPUs, those models are performing very well. And for some activities, you don't need to load even a Llama 3 or bigger, because those models, like in the video I showed you yesterday or the day before with the V3 from Microsoft, models with even less than 4 billion parameters, which are performing really well. So here we create the pipeline text generation. We use the tokenizer, the and end of sentence token. Here we are just doing an example with zero prompt, zero shot. Here the model is not very consistent. In this case, we do as well. Here we do one shot or few shot prompting, but only with one example, and you can see here that only sending an example, well, the model is quite good, it's very well trained, and you can see here that is providing a correct label for the example. Here we had a complete example with three different examples, one per category, and exactly the same. The model is performing well. Take a look here, is also able to understand emoticons, so quite impressive model for the size that it has. And that's it. You can see here that there is no big difference, practically the same that working in your local environment with Python. Here there is only few changes that you need to do, just to access the file system and to access the who interface token, and not much. Also how you install the libraries is advisable here, regardless the versions, to take a look to what is included on the Databricks runtime. You are using a machine learning runtime like we have here in our test cluster. take a look to the release notes of this ML runtime, as you had a lot of libraries, and what is really not advised is to, you see here we have a conflict with the libraries. You need to look at before install anything, especially in this way. It's better to take a look what is included on the release notes for that runtime, and later decide it is worth it to install it like this, or just go into the cluster and install it here, or even decide to install a different one just because you may break the runtime. It's not a big problem. You can change the runtime and rebuild the runtime. It's not going on. It's very strange if you lose something, but you can rebuild the cluster at any time. You don't lose tokens, you don't lose secrets, so you don't lose the code. But well, advisable. To first of all not use this, and before to use it check if how compatible are the versions that you are installing with the ones that you have on the runtime, especially again if you are using the ML runtimes. And that's all. I will push now this notebook to the repo, and I will put you a link in the description of the video. Again, that's all. Thank you for watching. I hope you like it and you find it interesting for your job and your training or whatever you do, or just for enjoyment. Give me a like if you enjoy with the video. Subscribe to the channel if you didn't do it before, and share with your friends or colleagues, just to help me to promote the channel. Thank you very much. Bye bye.